We're going to have a great time this afternoon. How's everyone doing? It seems a little quiet. We're doing all right. We have a lot of important issues here on the table today. I know there's a lot of lively discussions, but if things get kind of slow, you know what's going to happen, right? Lourdes and I are going to sing, right? I'm going to sing. Lourdes is going to sing a little backup.
No, I do the backup dancing, Dan. I don't actually sing. You have the voice.
Right. Well, for those of you who don't notice, I'm Dan Ponce and Lourdes Duarte of WGN Morning News. I know we have a lot of viewers here. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to wake up next to this smart and talented, beautiful woman. And you know her as Lourdes Duarte from the news, but I know a lot of you also know her as Zoraida Teresa Martinez Tez de Baca from WGN's telenovela, Noticias de mi Corazón.
Do I need to slap you right now? Is that gonna happen? Do my telenovela snap?
Yeah.
All right,
like that.
That's good. Yeah, so in case, for those of you who have not watched, you have to start. So Dan and I started this telenovela. We do it all in Spanish. It's you know, kind of tongue-in-cheek. We have some fun with it, and I get to slap everybody I see. Fake slaps, but I do get to do it.
Yeah. Well, all kidding aside, Lourdes and I are so happy to be here again. And 1 year later, we are still the city's only all-Latino anchor team on an English-speaking station. We were told it might be in the country, but we have to fact-check that. But definitely in the city of Chicago.
We're going with it. We're going to say the country. Why not? I do want to take a picture of everybody here, Dan. Do you mind if we take a little selfie?
There's a new trend going on among the anchors called the Anchor Convention. So everyone get real rowdy, make a lot of noise here. This is going to be all over social media, all over WGN here. All right. Nice.
And so we talk about social media. Obviously, you know how important it is. So make sure you use the hashtag. What is it this year? It's ILLCF2015 to share your pictures, your comments, your thoughts on how the conference has been going. I will post this picture as well. Make sure you comment on that. We would love to hear from you. So enjoy today's event. You are all seated, which means, Dan, we can continue.
And we're going to do things a little different this year. We're going to go ahead and introduce the keynote speaker. She's on a rather tight schedule here, but we are so fortunate here to welcome such a fantastic guest. If there's a growing face that, or there are many faces in the country that represent sort of the hybrid of Latin and English media on so many different levels, your keynote speaker today would be one of those faces here. Giselle Fernandez here. She's a legend here in Chicago. She's a legend across the country on so many different platforms. And the fun part about this all is that she and my dad used to work together at Channel 2 in the 1980s. Many of you know Phil Ponce, host of Chicago Tonight. I'm very proud of him. He's now, but he was a street reporter at Channel 2 for many, many years, and they worked together. So we're kind of coming full circle, Giselle, that I get to introduce you when you used to work with my father, but you're still just as talented and beautiful as you were in the 80s. Please welcome to the stage Giselle Fernandez, your keynote speaker.
I'll take a picture of you guys. I am the picture taker for social media today. So, Giselle, come on up.
The economy is not doing as well as you might like.
You have access to everything. You have the biggest house, the biggest tech gadgets, the biggest everything, and you keep things simple. Do you think that's part of the reason for your success? You kept things simple.
No, I think that any privilege, economic or education or anything, is a responsibility and a compromise.
Analysts say that Mexico in the next 25 years will become the new China if we invest and focus wisely. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely. Let's say that it will be Latin America.
How do you think you transcended it all? Was it an inherent spirituality, or do you think you learned along the way how to see the world that way?
Faith is the substance of things not seen. You hold on to those things that transcend time and gravity.
The very core of this organization's mission is compassion. I'll begin with, what is the responsibility of all of us here? To care for children who are not our own in all parts of the world, who are motherless and in need of that deep compassion.
Buenos dias.
Thank you.
Wow, it's so lovely to be home, sweet home, Chicago. Thank you so much for inviting me back to be with all of you today and to my Ponce legacy and to Lourdes, to have a Latino-Latina morning news team. You don't know how emblematic of the future that is and what a shining beacon that is for all of us here in America and what it's going to look like. So muchísimas gracias. I love Chicago. It's amazing to return and have people come to you and say, you worked with my father, and do you remember me from 30 years ago? And then I meet, and the reason why I really wanted to come, I meet these amazing young student scholarship winners. Not 25, as is normally the case, but 28, because there were so many maverick young minds to celebrate this year. And I get a chance to look them in the eye and see their dreams and tell them, when I was your age, when I was in my 20s, I was just starting out in the world, right from here, from Chicago, trying to make my mark in the world. And I looked at them and I saw myself. And it just made my heart sing, because they have all the promise and all the hope and all the ideals this country is desperate for right now. And I said to them, I'm looking at myself 25 years ago, and what I want to say to you is, use the next 25 years and the power that you have, every choice that you make wisely, because you can make a difference in the world today as no one else can, as Latino millennial powerhouses, the new economy of America and the future. So to all of you, the scholarship winners, the students in this room, I came to celebrate you. Felicidades. And to your families, felicidades. Oh my gosh, we live in such turbulent times, don't we? We live in such divisive times. So when I speak of students and their beautiful minds and their fresh ideals, we need your ideas. We need your multicultural understanding and experience. We need your understanding of global citizenry. We need your understanding for the need for equity, an end to disparity of wealth and opportunity. We need your mix of genius and perspective. Sometimes we in the Hispanic community have felt so unentitled to stand up and be leaders because we come from humble beginnings. And discrimination and bigotry and racism defines often who we are in the headlines. And despite our immense power, 52 million strong, almost $2 trillion in buying power, 1 million millennials, Latinos, will turn 18 this year. That means a million new voters. What power we have for this next 2016 election. And internet, mobile phone usage dominance, we have the world, we Latino millennials, at our fingertips. My gosh, the influence we have over our economy, our politics, our culture is staggering. And yet, because we come from humble beginnings, we often don't feel entitled enough to use the power that we have. Somos como abuelos behind a Ferrari. And it's time now to put our pedal to the metal and drive this sucker to a new America. I just came back from Mexico, and I love La tierra de mi nacimiento. I was born there. My mother, she knew long ago that this was going to be the cool trend. She was a New Yorker. She was a Jew. She goes, I'm going to Mexico over the summer. She met my father, a flamenco dancer, 3 times her age. They got married. I was born. Explains everything, doesn't it? But she knew then. I always talk about this because young people in the room listen to this. My mom was born a New Yorker. She didn't like the concrete jungle. That was her fate. She went to Mexico and she found her soul. And she married a Mexican, pero su zapateado en otras mujeres va así, rapidísimo. But she stayed Mexican. She didn't stay married. She stayed Mexican. And she became a flamenco dancer. And she became have a love for Mexico, its culture, its history, its magnificence, its indigenous heritage. And today she's almost 80 years old, and she's a mariachi singer in East LA and in Mexico. And let me tell you the significance of that. It doesn't matter what circumstances you're born into, you have a song in your heart to sing. That is your destiny. My mom taught me a love of Mexico, a love of my indigenous heritage, the pride and orgullo in mi cultura, and she lives it to this day, but her circumstances never defined her. She's not Madeline Eisner. Her name on stage is Tequila, and I'm not lying. So when I was in Mexico, I was at a wellness conference, and we were gathered with some of the greatest experts and authorities on bringing wellness into the world. How do we bring wellness into the world? And it's not just how we take care of our bodies and the nutrition that we put into our bodies. It's how we are inspired to think bigger than our circumstances. It's how we are financially able to take care of our families and our communities. It's our buildings and our eco and our environmental consciousness that creates wellness in communities. And I thought, well, how do we create wellness in communities where obesity and nutrition and diabetes is so far off track because of poverty and where disparities of wealth particularly hit our community, our underserved communities, where there's so much talent, so much potential, so much fuerza in our demographic numbers, but we don't have access to the dream. No access to capital to grow our businesses, to grow out of sole proprietorship. We are the fastest growing economy in the world. We are the entrepreneurship that surpasses other demographics, but we can't get access to the dream that is our America. So how do you create wellness? And this amazing Mayan shaman came up. He said something very interesting. He said, this time is the ending of 500 years of tears where male patriarchal dominance, dominion over others, hierarchy, you're less than, we're the ruling class, where disconnection from heart, disconnection from nature and how we care for Mother Earth, violence, this has ruled these hundreds of years. But now, right now, we are all living in a time when these Mayans, our ancient ancestors, their blood courses through the veins of every Latino in this room. They are in your essence. They are in your veins. They are in your third eye, tu tercer ojo, que sabe todo. You have a wisdom here. It's not a matter of do you have it, it's will you turn it on and access it. If you do, he says, the children of the sun in the Americas, in the United States, if we turn that on, we will access our ancient wisdom, and we will be able to be the ones that the ancient ancestor said of this time are the ones we've been waiting for. You, particularly the young people, you are the ones we've been waiting for. To do what? To usher in, this Mayan shaman said, a new paradigm of leadership that's not about dominion or materialism or greed or ego. Not about divisiveness. It's about unity. It's about ushering a harmonious convergence, giving rise to what we call the divine feminine of collaboration, of seeing ourselves in each other, of recognizing, as the Mayans did when they greeted each other, they would shake hands and form the universal spiral, the sacred circle, and they would say to each other, a la kesh, a la ken. I am you, and you are me, recognizing that the light in their eyes is the same light that shines in your own, and it comes from the same source. We are one people. We are one family. We are each other. This is in our knowing, we Latinos. This is mythology. It's romantic, but it's real. My friends, we have come so far away, so disconnected from our hearts, so disconnected from our humanity, so disconnected from what we know is right. The young people, the millennials, are disconnected from that establishment way of thinking. Look what's happening on college campuses today. Look what happened in Missouri. The football team threatened to boycott unless that chancellor and that president quit because they didn't like the racism, the discrimination on campus. They didn't wait for the college board of trustees or the established leaders to make change. They saw what that was doing. They threatened to boycott, and they made change happen. That is not an isolated incident. There's a renaissance of student activism erupting all over this nation. Just yesterday in Occidental College in California, there was a student sit-in and they were in tents. Why? Because they said minority students were not being treated fairly. Enough with the inequities. It happened in Ithaca, it happened at Bryn Mawr, it's happened all over, and they're hashtagging and using technology to spread the word. This will not continue. It's unconscious. I can't help but think when I see this 1960s renewed consciousness activism, then it was the age of love. We're returning to an age of consciousness. The Mayans talked about it. As harmonious convergence, a different kind of leadership where we usher in a new way of being. I return to a state, blessed state of Illinois, that passed the Dream Act, that got driver's license reform. God bless you, but you can't pass a budget in 6 months? I'm not here to point a finger at the gridlock in Springfield, believe me. That's not my point, but my point is divisiveness. Deadlock, gridlock in politics is crushing this nation. You know, politics, when I was your age, young people, I wanted to be in politics. I wanted to change the world. Gosh, politics today will beat that out of you. It's so cruel, it's so inhumane, it's so unconscious. Grown-ups are acting like children with bruised egos and need for power at our expense. When there's no budget and it's some justifiable reason that business interests will secure our economy over this waste while our people suffer most, it's unconscious. The disparity between rich and poor is at a 50-year high, while the S&P 500 is also at a 50-year high. The rich got richer and the poor got poorer, but we are 52 million strong. So where's the reconciliation of that duality? We are so powerful. Our numbers are so immense. We are no longer a minority. And yet we act like a mindset of minorities. Why? Because of our humble beginnings. This is our home. We helped build America. We've helped shape America. So when people say, get to the back of the line and pay a fee, I'm like, are you out of your mind? You let us in here to build your America. We're not machines. We had families here who also have become Americans, and now you say go home when you need us a political football to kick around? There is no discussion. It's not acceptable anymore to have that dialogue. We are not what's broken. The system is what's broken. It is amnesty across the board. We're here. This is our house. We built it. period. So how do we become entitled, you, the generation with the digital dominance? It's interesting, Atlantis, the lost city of Atlantis, was said to have gone under when their technological advances, their immense innovations, kept escalating but without consciousness, without heart. ISIS uses the internet to recruit. We know the perils of technology, and we don't even can't even fathom what's ahead. But we also know the immense universe and access to the dream, the democratization of the dream that the internet has brought all of us. But we millennial Latinos who have so much voice and have so much power, if we use it, can use that technology for such good if we're conscious. And what does that mean? How do we become entitled? How do we share the message? By sharing your stories, by sharing your humble beginnings, by showing who you are. Our stories are the stories of America. Our stories are the most triumphant, inspiring, emblematic ideals that this nation was built upon. I was speaking to some of the young people, and we were talking about 26th Street here in Chicago, and how Spanish language media and English language media are still so divided. In Los Angeles as well and across the nation, it's almost like we're two separate worlds still. Our issues, jobs, access to capital, healthcare, inclusion in the Affordable Care Act, immigration reform, these are not Latino issues, these are America's issues. You invest in us, you're investing in America's future. Put your hands together, that's an applausible moment. But if our media is divided and doesn't see us as unified in the vision of the Mayans, I am you, you are me, how do we get our message across of who we are? Do we let Donald Trump define who we are? He is not only wrong, he's ignorant. And I don't even like bringing up his name because it continues to fuel that archetype which is leading and triggering a nerve and a DNA in this country that needs to suppress this emerging power. So why would we allow others to define us when you have digital dominance and that technology to use consciously, to show and share who you are? But first it comes from what the shaman reminded me of in Mexico just last week. How do you feel worthy? How do you feel entitled to stand up and ask and demand what's right? How? The first thing he said is, come home. Come home to who you are. Come home to your heart, to what you know in here. You've seen your families struggle. You've seen them triumph. You know their sacrifices. You know how hard our mothers have worked, how fathers have worked, what they've given to be here, to give you all the shoulders to stand on. Come home to your heart, said the shaman. See the grace in you. Stop beating yourselves up for not being perfect. Just be present to the moment. Be present to who you are, to what your gifts are. God made you with your individual, certain, unique gifts. Don't be anybody else. Nurture that in you, which is yours to give the planet, to make it a better place. My God, we need your consciousness at this moment. The grown-ups are screwing things up. So where does that entitlement come from? From seeing your grace and then recognizing it in others so that we can take care of one another as one planet, one family, take care of our beautiful environment, Mother Earth. We can only do this if we first see the grace within our own selves. That's where we get our entitlement. It's God-given. It's, I'm here, God put me here to make a difference on the planet. One young person said to me today, but sometimes it's what you believe and what you feel is not the norm, and you have to go against the tide. And it's just, if you say and speak your truth, maybe it won't be accepted. And I say, embrace your warrior spirit. Connect to your heart. Connect to what's right. Connect to consciousness. And let others feel out of place for being on the wrong side of the light. It's time, as the Mayan said, for your emergence. I encourage you all to join the activism that we're seeing in our young people on college campuses across the country. But I encourage Latinos more, not just the young people, but our leaders, to stand up and be bold. Think of Dolores Huerta and Cesar Chavez and the boycott. Boycott NBC and Telemundo when they put that guy on the air. We watch more TV and stream more web videos than any other demographic on the planet. If you boycotted their stations, trust me, they'd never put that man on again, no matter how high the ratings were. You have that leverage. Use it. Telling our stories. I have a few minutes, and I'd like to share with you one story. This is a young person, and I found her on social media, and I went to her. Because it's from our humble beginnings that is our grace and our strength. Our communities, people in need, need your voice, our voice, to champion our interests and see what's possible. I found this young woman, and we're trying to encourage in California all the legal permanent residents to become citizens so they can vote and have voice in the America they've worked so hard to build. I want you to meet her because she just exemplifies the American dream. What's possible when your family has sacrificed so much for you? And you tell me you can't have pride in what this woman will achieve and what she will contribute as a result to America. Please meet Eunice Gonzalez. ¿Está listo o no?
I am Elisa Gonzalez. I am a daughter of immigrant farm workers. I have just received my degree from UCLA. I plan to fight for the rights of immigrants. I am the first person to go to college in my family. I wrote a poem to express my gratitude for my parents during graduation, and this is how it goes. Mommy and Papi, we did it. After 22 long years of working in the strawberry field, of picking strawberries, nurturing the fresa, day after day, being kissed by the sun, I am finally your fruit today. I am the fresa you've worked so hard to preserve, to love, to nurture. Today, I am ready to be the sweetest thing you ever did grow. This degree is for the immigrant families that have crossed borders and who have thrived. Mommy, Papi, this degree is ours. The strawberries can no longer claim you as their own. It means that the hard work I did throughout college wasn't only my own, that this has been a work in progress for 22 long years, and my parents have been doing all the work since I was born. It has motivated me to continue and to look for refuge in academia and education so that one day they don't have to work that hard anymore. I plan to hopefully become an immigration lawyer or become a professor in ethnic studies or gender studies and keep educating people and hopefully rid anyone of ignorance through my education. When I hear all these negative things about our community, it frustrates me because we are hard workers. We are not rapists, we are not criminals, we are not murderers. We are here to work hard. We are here to give back to this country. We work hard in the fields, in doing construction work, domestic work. The U.S. would do nothing without the people doing the back-breaking labor. Enough of all the negativity. We are one. We need to work together and keep America great. I think it's important that I give back to the people who have worked so hard to build not only my future, but the future of this country. I wanted to honor my parents with my diploma because it was their diploma too. I am the only American citizen in my family. I wish they had the same resources that I do, but I'm going to work hard to make sure that they can have the experiences I've had, and that my sisters can go to college too, and that my parents can be given the dignity and respect that they deserve. We need to work together to protect the America we have worked so hard to build. If you've been here for 5 years and have no criminal record, apply to citizenship. We need your voice so that we can shape our own future and not leave it to the hands of anyone else. This is our America too. Citizenship now.
Is she brilliant? Is she our story? Is she your story? The power of our real stories is the power of America. There's no one that can dispute the beauty and the triumph of not just Eunice, but of her amazing parents. They are what America is all about. I have time to share one more video. And I share this one with you because this one touched my heart the most. We have the power to transform through our stories. When negative things are said about us, who do you think that hurts? Our children. How dare anyone call our children anchor babies? Mitarelli.
Mi nombre es Adelie. Yo nací en este país. Soy ciudadana americana. Soy como tu hija. Son inmigrantes. Nacieron en México, trabajaron muy duro por mí. Ellos me ayudaron a ser una buena persona, a lograr un sueño americano. ¿Por qué dicen eso? Cuando dicen que nosotros no tenemos que ir. Me siento sentir mal porque yo nací aquí, pero mis padres no. Y yo quiero estar con ellos donde ellos vayan. Yo no quiero que las personas cambien las reglas, no nomás afectan a las personas que son inmigrantes, sino también a los niños que no van a poder seguir a sus padres. Yo como ciudadana aquí tengo el derecho de decir lo que es bueno y lo que es malo y defender a los niños igual como yo. Nosotros tenemos una voz. Todos tenemos un destino en esta vida. Yo quiero que mis padres pertenecen aquí conmigo para siempre. Esta es mi casa, este es mi país, esto es mi todo. Nosotros somos una familia, un país. Cuando yo crezca, yo quiero ser el presidente de los Estados Unidos. Y yo lo puedo hacer. Todo lo que...
We must not let anyone else define us any longer. I believe the Mayans. They gave me so much hope in troubled times when I'm disgusted with our politics, so disheartened and heartbroken over how we've become so divided in this nation. And my faith and hope is in the young people, the Hispanic millennials, who at their fingertips have the opportunity to use the cyber highway for such good. And we do that best by tapping into our hearts, our wisdom, our consciousness, our sense of unity, and sharing our amazing stories. The more we share who we are, who we really, really are, the more we stand up and be bold and stand up for what's right, what's conscious, what's human. Not what's what the establishment says is how it is, but how we know it should be. then we're fulfilling not just the Mayan prophecies that you are the ones we've been waiting for. We're fulfilling the great masters of our history, like Gandhi, who said, be the change we hope to see in the world. I am counting on you. Thank you, Chicago.
Unbelievable. How about a standing ovation for Giselle Fernandez? That was wonderful. And Giselle, we know your home is in Los Angeles, but we want to have you come back in Chicago and visit us. So thank you again.
We're going to give you a little entertainment here as you enjoy the rest of your lunch and before we begin the scholarship. So you heard Dan mention at the beginning of the show that he has put together a telenovela. We are the main actors in this. And if you have not seen it, we thought we would share it with you.
All right. So this is episode 3, our most recent episode of the WGN Morning News telenovela, Noticias de mi Corazón.
Me he perdido parte de mi alma. Este es un día muy triste para todos.
Thanks to Senor Bill Curtis for the payoff at the end.
Yes, very nice. And I'll tell you a little secret. Did you guys listen to the song at the beginning of the telenovela, the introduction? Were you paying attention? That is Dan singing, by the way. That is his voice. He wrote it, put it together, went to a studio and recorded this thing. Like, he has put this whole thing together. He comes up with the script. I'm just so proud of you for putting...
You know, that we Mexicans take our telenovelas very seriously.
He really does. So thank you, Dan, for giving us some comic relief today and always at work. So we appreciate it. And I apparently am a pretty good dramatic actress, I think. Thank you. And thank you for playing along with us and watching that. We got a kick out of it as well. So now we get to do one of my favorite parts of this event, and that is giving out the scholarships. 28 scholarships are going out today, $2,000 scholarships, and that is a really big deal. Some of you have heard me talk about this before. I was raised by a single mom. Money is always, you know, hard to come by when you're in that situation, and had it not been for scholarships that I received growing up, I probably wouldn't have been able to go to college and graduate and do what I'm doing today and give some mean slaps. Yeah. So thank you. I want to call up a few people up on stage to present those scholarships. Senator Iris Martinez, if you can come on up.
Iris Martinez.
State Representative Elizabeth Hernandez, or Hernandez.
Elizabeth.
And then also the vice chair of this event, Michael Gonzalez, to come up to present several recognitions.
You want to say a few words?
Yes. Hi, we're back again. Thank you. First and foremost, I just want to make sure that all the legislators that are here can please stand up. We have Representative Will Gazzardi right here.
Gazzardi!
Yay! Our former co-chair and will always be our state rep, Eddie Acevedo. I know that a representative of Arroyo was here earlier. He'll be back. I know Chapo La Villa was here. She'll be back. I have Representative Fred Crespo. And can all the UC, all the foundation members please stand up? We have Craig Chico, Dr. Pedro Ceballos Candu, Lisbeth Ramirez, Gilbert Villegas, Raul Reyes, Dean Olson, Valdemar Lopez, Steve Carmelli, Peter Vina, Dr. Andrew Sun, Daniel Arce, Martin Cabrera, Victor Reyes, Michael Gonzalez, Alice Morales, and Stella Gaitan. Those are our foundation members who work in partnership with us. I also want to acknowledge Cook County Commissioner, the great Junior, Louis Arroyo Jr. I know in the audience we also have our director, of labor, Hugo Chaviano. Where's Hugo? Hugo's right there. Rocco Clapp, our human rights. There he is back there. Is there any other director or secretary or any other?
Oh yeah, representative.
Oh, there's a Commerce Commission.
We also have Representative Bob Pritchard from DeKalb.
Oh, and we have Mayor Barrett Peterson from, is that Franklin Park? That's right, our friend from Franklin Park. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, as you know, that the advancement of Latinos in Illinois is a cooperative venture, bigger than the, let me save the best for last, and that is our wonderful, and it was our former superintendent, Jesse Ruiz. He's everything to us. He's a pro bono lawyer. He is a great individual who sits on that board and makes things happen for us at CPS. Thank you for your time. Stand up. I want everybody to give Jesse Ruiz a standing ovation. This man has done a great job over in CPS. So let's go back to now the scholarships. Thank you all for the excellent panelists who shared today their knowledge and expertise with us this morning. They deserve a round of applause. To all the panelists, please stand up so everybody can see you. Where are the panelists? Are they still here? Let's give them a nice hand. They did a great job today keeping it going and really bringing their expertise and their resources to us. That is why we also use our annual conference to recognize some of the wonderful programs and individuals who work alongside of us to improve the lives of those in our communities. Michael, you're up. I think you're next.
Thank you very much, Senator. Before I actually start, I'd like to ask if Jessica Carrillo is in the room, raise your hand. I'd like you to meet with one of our staffers because you're missing an item. Or you can give me the PIN number and then I'll use it. So please see Laurie. Okay, that's fine. Okay, each year the foundation honors those that have done particularly important positive influence on policy and practice benefiting Latinos in Illinois. The awardees before you represent several professional, governmental, and community service areas. And the awardees know who they are. They're printed in the program. And I'd like to call them up one by one. There is a little bio on them, but I'll excerpt a little portion of each. Melissa Hernandez is the director of Puerto Rico Project. She's on the front lines assisting Puerto Ricans addicted to heroin. One of her big supporters is a great friend and one of our foundation members, Senator William Delgado. She's from Humboldt Park, and please join us here to receive your recognition. We'll ask you to say a few words.
I'd like to thank the Illinois Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation for allowing me to be here today. I am grateful and honored by this recognition, and I thank you for acknowledging my efforts to help these men and women that are out on the streets. But we need to understand that there is a huge need for services out there, and our government agencies and officials should come up with some form of legislation that will prevent secret rehab groups like the 24-hour groups from providing unregulated treatment to drug users. There is also a huge need for more drug rehabilitation services, and I plan on opening recovery homes in my community. Defeating all my fears and fighting for social justice didn't make this possible. I wouldn't be here today without the love and compassion of State Senator William Delgado, Lucy Roman, reporter Adriana Cardona, Sheriff Tom Dart and his department, and Compassion to the Rescue Organization. I want to thank you. I want to thank my two boys, Jimmy and Joshua, who both have borrowed me some of their super strength and love when I felt like giving up. And I want to thank the people without whom this project would not exist, the survivors of human trafficking fighting to reclaim their lives. I could have done it without you guys. Thank you all again.
Very eloquent comments. Thank you, Melissa. I'd like to ask State Representative Fred Crespo and Assistant Superintendent of the Illinois State Board of Education, Reina Hernandez, to join me as I read a very excerpt of the bio for Mr. Matt John Rodriguez. He's actually the first Hispanic male president of the Illinois PTA. He's committed to equipping community members to be strong advocates. And we recognize his contributions to the community. And actually, Reina Hernandez is going to accept on his behalf. He had to leave early.
It is truly a privilege to be here, to have the opportunity to recognize Matthew, because if most of you probably don't know him because he's very quiet, I think he embodies our hard work and humility, and so he does the hard work, but he doesn't take credit for it. So to have this opportunity, you know, he has this tremendous resume. He is on over a dozen ISBE boards and committees, and he's active. He actually shows up. And he's on the White House Fatherhood Initiative, first Latino Illinois PTA president. We said, how does he do all of that? Well, he works 12 and a half hour shifts at night so that he can volunteer at, you know, sometimes 8-10 hours during the day, moving from state different communities, really trying to empower kids and families, and not forgetting to take care of his delightful son, Joshua, and his older son, Mateo. So he had some words. He couldn't be here because he is presenting on behalf of the PTA at the III conference right now. He said, "Ladies and gentlemen, words cannot express how honored and humbled I am to receive this award in mommy's name." His grandmother passed away already. "But this award is really for every single one of us in this room. Every single one of us knows, whether first, second, or third hand, the struggles of our Latino children and families. Our elders don't let us forget, as they shouldn't. Every day, in all of our actions, in all of our pieces of legislation introduced, we need to make sure we are making the best possible decisions for our children and families. Because in case you haven't heard, Latinos are due to be the majority minority by 2020. I look forward to working together towards a better future. Si se puede. Thank you, Matthew John Rodriguez." Thank you.
I'm very brief. It's a shame he wasn't here for you to meet him. I've known him actually for almost 10 years, and I represent the northwest suburbs. I'm actually, I think, the only Latino from a non-Latino district, and he lives out there in Schaumburg as well. So it's always nice when you have a Latino who puts us in a good light in the suburbs, and he is really a good example for many of us. It's funny how they always consider us leaders, but I look at him as being a leader in the Northwest community. So if you ever meet him, I think you'll be very impressed and very proud of him as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fred.
Thank you very much, Representative. Our next recipient is Maricela Garcia. I've known her for a number of years, and I didn't realize her history includes serving at Casa Guatemala, the Illinois Coalition of Immigrant and Refugee Rights, National Council of La Raza, and now CEO of Gads Hill Center. And because that's in the district, the local district where Representative Edward Acevedo and Senator Antonio Munoz are representatives, could you please join us as we ask Maricela to accept her recognition?
Thank you very much to the Legislative Caucus for this award, and thank you, all of you, for being here today, honoring the not only the awardees, but also the recipients of the scholarships. I am very proud of the work that for many years I have done since I came to this country in order to advance the rights, the civil rights agenda, and pursue a better life for Latinos in this country. I'm also proud of being an immigrant. I think that that is something that has driven me to work always to seek the opportunity for Latino families to stay together. We saw those videos in which there is so much pain for family separations, and we need to do something to stop because it is not part of the American values. When I asked families yesterday about what I should say when I accepted this award, the families that come to Gadshill Center, they told me that I should say to you, especially to the legislators, that what they need is higher wages, that they need to make the minimum wages too low, that they need to make more money to uplift their families out of poverty. They also asked me to make sure that in the budget there is enough money for childcare because they need that support in order to go to work. They also asked me to share with you that there have to be more programs for youth in the neighborhoods so they have safe places to be. Not all the neighborhoods are safe for children and they need those programs. So I am conveying to you the urgent needs that the families from that Gadshill serves, from Brighton Park, from Pilsen, from Little Village, from back of the yard. I don't think that what they're asking is unrealistic. I think that our society should take that responsibility to support working families and make sure that we uphold the American values that every family that works hard, works 40 hours a day, should be able not to live in poverty. So that's why I want to thank the Legislative Caucus, Latino Legislative Caucus Foundation, for the award, for the scholarships for the children, because that gives them a leg up to continue and achieve their full potential. But I also want to tell to the legislators here today another message that came from many of my colleagues who are in the nonprofit world, that please, we are every step behind you. We congratulate you for your hard work, but please work harder the next month because we need that budget to pass in January.
Thank you very much, Maricela. Very eloquent. Our last recipients, I say that plural, and I promise there will not be any slapping because we have two awards. For folks from the Loyola University Chicago Stritch School of Medicine. So being a recipient of a Jesuit education myself, I can appreciate what Drs. Linda Brubacher and Dr. Mark Kajewski have done for the community. Dr. Brubacher is a prolific researcher with multiple research grants and has executed those faithfully and honestly. Dr. Mark Kajewski is both a medical school professor and a clinical bioethicist. He has been an articulate spokesperson for just and equitable treatment of immigrant patients. So for that, we recognize your participation and your contributions to the community. And actually, could I have Lila Suleiman Gonzalez to join us for the photo op?
Thank you all. On behalf of our medical school, and more importantly, on behalf of the students we serve and the students we hope to serve someday, we gratefully accept this very important award and honor for our school. Thank you very much. Our medical school welcomes and offers educational opportunity to all students, and we were really excited to welcome and open our doors to DACA-documented students 2 years ago, when the largest group of DACA students in the United States entered medical education. Mm-hmm. Those seven students are now in their second year of medical school, coming up on their halfway point to becoming physicians that can work in our state and many states in our nation, and will join forces to help meet the growing need for physicians in all communities in our nation. We doubled that number this last year with 14 students entering our first year class. So that cadre of students represents 71% of the DACA documented medical students here in our state at our school. And I thought you might like to know that our state actually has an MD PhD student. That's a very rigorous degree of at least 7 years of study, where the student graduates with both an MD as well as a PhD degree. It's a very rigorous study, very competitive, and we have a DACA documented student in that program now.
Awesome. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you may wish to read his blog, which was just on, I think, the Huffington Post. Cesar is a very articulate young man, and you may wish to read his perspective on how it's now easier for him to get an MD PhD than it is to actually get a visa. So thank you for this award. We're so grateful for this honor. We take it to our hearts. It's much appreciated.
So hi, all. Before we go to the next award, and it's rather an award, it's going to be a surprise to this particular person. But before I do that, I think it is appropriate at this time to talk about, or at least stress about, the upcoming bill, the access bill, an educational bill, that we are going to be moving, both myself and Senator Martinez, this coming session. And this will allow undocumented to receive further funding through the state universities, whether in a competitive basis. So this is one more step ahead to furthering educational opportunities for undocumented. But I have to stress, we have accomplished many of what we have done on a bipartisan effort. And I want to give a special thanks to State Representative Bob Pritchard, who has stuck it out with us, understands these students, and I want to thank him personally and in front of all of you very much. So, and now we have another award, but this time, it is an award from the community to our co-chair, Senator Iris Martinez. I would like to have Sylvia Gonzalez, who is the community school coordinator at McAuliffe Elementary School, a former parent mentor, if she can come up, and current Grow Your Own teacher candidate, to present a special award to the senator. So Sylvia, she'll describe a little bit about it.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, I want to say my name is Sylvia Gonzalez. I'm an immigrant from Mexico. I'm a parent mentor graduate and also a candidate of GYO, yes, through Logan Square Neighborhood Association. I am a mother, a wife, a sister, a daughter. Most of my time I spend with my children. But when it's not with my children, I spend my time with my other children at McAuliffe Elementary School, where I oversee a program of 200 students for after school. My work as a parent mentor introduced me to teaching, and I fell in love, and it became my passion. With the help of Grow Your Own, I'm in the pathway to becoming a bilingual certified teacher. Without these two programs, my dreams would have not been possible without the dedication and commitment of Senator Iris Martinez. these programs would not exist. Recently, Grow Your Own was designated as a bright spot in Hispanic education by the White House Initiative for Educational Excellence for Hispanics. Grow Your Own was recognized because it is committed to providing an opportunity for non-traditional students like myself to become teachers. It provides a pathway for community leaders, parents, and volunteers to fulfill their dreams and become teachers in their neighborhood schools, which I plan to do. Just like me, GYO teachers live and are in the community of our neighborhoods. We strengthen the fabric of our communities in our schools. We enrich the lives of students and we inspire them, and we are also the role models of our children. Without the tireless advocacy of our Senator Martinez, Grow Your Own and other programs like it that prioritize Latino education and opportunity would not exist. In recognition of all her amazing work to ensure access and opportunity for Latinos, I am proud to present Senator Iris Martinez with the Guiding Star for Latino Education Award on behalf of Grow Your Own and Logan Square Neighborhood Association.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. You know what? It's funny. I wasn't expecting this. I had a script that was given to me yesterday. That part wasn't in there. So today when I get the script and I'm standing up here looking at what's next on the script, I see, oh my God, I'm getting an award. But Jesus, thank you. You know what? This started off as a thought. It was a seed that was planted about 10 years ago. I know that it's had its struggles because, you know what? We were not, according to some of the folks in the appropriations committee, we were not doing it fast enough, but it took time. It took time to get the program going. It took time to find parents, students out there. And we're talking about parents like Susan right here, who had a dream and never thought it would happen. And today, to know that LSNA in my district has been able to produce already many teachers that right now are in the classrooms, are in the hard to staff, the most hard, difficult neighborhoods where teachers come in and leave right away. Our whole thought was to make sure that we grow our own teachers within our own community so that, because they live there, they're committed, they're vested, and that's why I think this program is successful, because we're seeing more and more folks coming in to the into the pipeline, and we hope to continue to keep the dollars going because this program is important and we are creating our very own teachers. Thank you very much for this.
Okay, as they're taking those photographs, I'm gonna get started on actually the highlight of the celebration today. Don't forget, everybody that's here, hashtag ILLCF 2015, and like us on Facebook. So now we're gonna award 28 worthy college students with scholarships to help them achieve their educational and personal goals. Pretty neat. Over the last 13 years, we've awarded more than $500,000 to outstanding Latino college students, thanks to the support of so many of you in the audience. We have a huge list of corporations backing us up and individuals backing us up. We appreciate that. I'd like to thank our keynote speaker Giselle Fernandez, and foundation member Dan Arce from Tropical Optical, both of whom helped us expand the number of recipients from 25 to 28. Isn't that neat? Thank you, Dan, and thank you, Giselle. Now, scholarship winners, you're lined up on my left. As your name is called, please come up to be honored, and then after you're recognized, please remain on the right side, just down the steps and on the right side. So here we are. We're lined up in alphabetical order, right, Janet? Our first recipient from the University of Illinois at Chicago, Maritza Aceves. Woo! From Northern Illinois University, Roel Alcantar Luna. From Lake Forest College, Evelyn Bayo. Now, we have most of the students here, but some had tests and other important things. If they didn't make it, it's for a good reason. From Harold Washington College, Ali Chavez. From Parkland College, Kellen Cuevas Tovar. Also from the University of Illinois at Chicago, Mateo Diaz. He's got a support group there. Southern Illinois University, Martin Galindo. Okay. I'll get back to Martin. Martin had could not make it, and I'll have some remarks from him later, hopefully. Are we caught up?
Yes, we are.
Okay. From the University of Illinois at Springfield, Manuel Gomez. From Lewis University, Marvin Gomez. From the University of Illinois at Chicago, Alma Y. Gonzalez. From the Illinois Institute of Technology, studying business, Magdalena Gonzalez. Also from the Illinois Institute of Technology, Jose Hernandez.
So, are you studying engineering?
Sorry, mechanical engineering.
So that's real nice. He's studying mechanical engineering. So maybe I'll end up having a chance to hire him sometime in the future. From Loyola University, Chicago, Johanna Jimenez. From Eastern Illinois University, Mario Lara. Not here. And if a student wasn't able to join us today, we'll make sure we get the check and the plaque over to them. From Loyola University, Mayra Martinez. From Illinois State University, Julia Mendez. From the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, Priscilla Monsivais. Okay, from Northern Illinois University, Shareni Mota Reyes. Okay, Sharena. Okay, from Eastern Illinois University, Bianca M. Navejas. No? Okay, so Dominican University, Carmen Olivares. Not present. From Illinois State University, Luis Perales. Okay, so we've got a big group from Illinois State. Congratulations. From North Park University, Gerson Ramirez. From William Rainey Harper College, Nancy Ramirez Blancas. From the University of Illinois at Chicago College of Nursing, Eva Ramos. From Dominican University, Daniela Roman. From the University of Illinois at Chicago, Yesenia Salgado. From Northern Illinois University, Gladys Concio Sanchez. And it appears our last recipient from Wheaton College, Jasmine Valdez, still deserves a round of applause, could not join us. These are our new scholarship recipients for 2015, and now members of a new initiative, our recipient alumni group. You'll be hearing from one of our ringleaders, a former recipient, Jesus Alquicira. We're going to organize in a way that helps you help yourself. We're going to collaborate. We invite you to be a part of it. You'll be reached out to, as will other previous recipients. So we believe that you are part of a talent pool that we can help promote you and what your endeavors are. So good luck with all that, and now we're going to take some photos. Okay, can I have all the rest of the elected officials and also the foundation members to join us for photographs? Thank you so much. Are we done here? Are you guys? We're done. Back to.
Before I head off to take some pictures, I do just want, I think this is an appropriate time to stress what is currently happening. And I think all of you are aware of the closure of doors to our Syrian refugees. I am asking, we are doing our part on our end, and I am going to ask if we can submit some sort of resolution to basically really maintain, and this is very important, what is occurring right now is a fear of blanket is being placed over this nation. And I think each one of us has a responsibility to break that. We must continue with our lives, not having fear of this. So I'm asking you, just as social media is being used to hurt, that we do the reverse. So continue with your lives normally. This is not, should not place any fear in your lives. On the contrary, work at consoling and getting across, because fear is only going to create more racism. Please keep that in mind. Iris, if you have.
And then same with adding to what Lisa's saying, right now there is a process that has been in place by the federal government, as many of the refugees that have left their countries for fear of their lives, for the atrocities being committed against human nature. Many of these refugees have been coming into our states, into our country, and there has been a process that's been put in place that is working. It is working. It should not be any different for the people coming from Syria. So let's be patient. Let's make sure that we embrace, you know, for what we are, the state that embraces immigrants at the highest level. So let's just continue to work with our government, making sure, be vigilant out there. But you know what? We cannot let racism and fear dominate our lives. So, in saying that, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your, you know, for being here today. And more important, we still are just halfway through. So let's have some fun.
All right, I think we have come to the end. I want to say something to the students that won the scholarships this afternoon. So now it is your opportunity to pay it forward, and what that means is that you have to try to help your community as much as you can with the resources that you have, because I always say this, and you guys are probably sick of me saying it, volunteering, paying it forward, is the price you pay for the space you occupy on Earth. So remember that, and I hope those students remember this as they go on to college, graduate, build successful lives. So thank you, everybody, for having us. I'm very happy to be here with Mr. Dan Ponce.
Always a pleasure. We'll see you next year. And don't forget to stick around. The town hall meeting starts at 2 o'clock. Lourdes and I probably won't stick around because she has to get to her happy hour over at Olive Garden that she always hosts on Friday. Here comes the fake slap. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a great day.